YouTube. Had a bunch of requests for a video or two on my World War One U.S. Doughboy impressions. Their impression, rather. Since the U.S. was only involved for about a year in World War One, and actually only in combat for a little over 5 months, I'll do this video, but even within that year, they still had at least three major uniform changes. First being when they got to their training sites in 1917, most of them got issued the new 1917 uniform, which is what I'm wearing, instead of the 1912, which was made out of a nicer wool. It was more uniform, more the color was more consistent. So they got issued M1917 uniforms, which were a little bit more coarse and all that stuff. And then they wore the 1917 through the end, even post-armistice. So I'm going to show you this, which is the just arriving in France, typical doughboy with the campaign hat. I'm going to go through all the gear and kind of show you what they would have had at that point. And then we'll move on to the actual fighting portion from like early June, late May, 1918, all the way until November. And I'll show you the post-armistice uniforms and explain some things that are kind of passed off as common knowledge, but they're really kind of more of a myth than they are reality. So the unit I portray is the Wisconsin and Michigan National Guard, the 32nd Division, which was formerly all the state regiments that were federalized in 1917. They had just gotten back from the border on the Mexican border with the whole incident with Pancho Villa in 1916. And they were federalized into the 32nd Division, and they mobilized out of Camp MacArthur in Waco, Texas. So they went back to Texas shortly after they got back from Texas. And they trained up there, and they had a lot of new equipment, including the 1903 commonly referred to as the Springfield. That's why I'm carrying this for our unit, because they actually went over to France with the 1903 that they had purchased from the federal government in 1916 when they were on the border doing service. So that's why I have this. I'll get into a rifle that was later used, but I think you all know what that is. I'll just still show you. For the gear, all I've got is the standard. Usually they would have had pea green equipment. I don't have a pea green belt. These came out in 1917 and before. There's a mix of khaki and pea green all throughout history of the 1910 equipment coming out. So I chose to wear the pinch pocket or something like that at the bottom. They were designed to hold the rounds in a little tighter. I don't know if they actually worked. I can't tell the difference when I have live rounds in them. Got the M1910 first aid pouch. Inside they would have had the little tin wrapped field dressing. For this one, I don't have that in here because I actually use a real bandage from route reenacting if somebody trips and falls and cuts something open. So it looks the part from the outside. But yeah, that was just, it was similar to the World War II version, a little tin wrapping on it, and you open it up with a little pull ring, and then you apply it to the wound as necessary. Then the canteen, this is a pea green cover that's kind of been used and dirty, so it doesn't look pea green anymore. I got the eagle snaps on it. Inside is the 1910 canteen, which originally had a flat cover on it, but by 1917 they started replacing it with this rounded cover, or cap rather, sorry, not a cover. This holds a quart of water, a bunch of different makers. This one's AGMC 1918, so it's not totally correct for 1917, but you get the idea. Inside, I'm not going to pull it out because it's a pain in the ass to get in and out, is the 1910 canteen cup. It's very similar to the World War II one with the L-shaped handle on it. The only difference between the World War I and World War II ones was this, as you can see, has a rolled lip on it, whereas the World War II ones have a raw lip on the cups. So that's how you can tell the difference between World War I and World War II if you can't find a date. So we'll put this back in here. It's a tiny canteen, really pretty inadequate for actual combat stuff if you don't have a constant supply of water. So we'll get into that in a little bit, and we'll show you some cool stuff. And then for the pack, I've got the M1910 haversack. This thing is pretty much how they would have been issued. You get your blanket, your shelter half, poles, and all that stuff for your shelter, for your pup tent. And then inside you've got like extra shirts, socks, underwear, a couple of little personal things like a shaving kit and all that stuff. I would take it apart, but it is a pain in the ass to get back together and get it all nicely rolled. On the left side you have the 1905 bayonet for the 1903 rifle. They would have had the other rifle, the 1917, they would have had the 1917 bayonet on it. Yeah, this is also a pain in the ass to get through, so that's why you see a lot of them in combat. They ditch the packs and they would carry the bayonet on their on their belt if they needed it. So then you've got the discs. The collar discs are actually a pretty neat thing. When we got activated, we were wearing the Wisconsin disc, or the WIS, and each state guard would have been wearing their respective state's disc. We got federalized, we were wearing the U.S. National Guard script disc, like this. So it's a USNG. So if you see that, that's what that means. The U.S. National Army, which was all the draftees, and they were making new units, would be a USNA in the script. And then a little bit afterwards, a few months after they came out with this, they came out with the USNG and NA, like, block, where it says U.S. on it, like the regular U.S. disc, but it's got a little square in the middle. It says either NG or NA for those. So that's kind of what those mean. On the left side would be your branch of service within the Army. So this one's infantry. Some units actually early on had their regimental numbers and their company letters, or, you know, battery letters or whatever, you know, artillery engineers, actually made into their discs. So you see a few of these. I actually copied this from an original 32nd tunic that I have, which I also made a video on. And this is the company we're portraying. It was kind of cool because that's the unit I was actually in. And it was like one in a million to find one of these because they were mostly custom made by units, like a little small order from the PX, or when they got overseas, they had some jewelers make it. So anyways, you see the regimental numbers. The regiment's going to be on the top. The company will be on the bottom. There's so many variations. It's really cool. If you want to know more about these, you can let me know and I can send you to a resource that's just a wealth of knowledge on collar discs for World War I. So that's what the collar discs mean. So when you're looking at a World War I uniform, try and look at the discs if you can, like in pictures, and that can tell you a lot about what unit your relative or just the random soldier was in. So this disc will be generally one of three or four, and then this will be medical, engineers, artillery, signal corps, you name it, quartermaster. And there's just a bunch of different variations. So the reason I only have one rank patch on is because when they got mobilized, or when they entered the war in 1917, they would have had two chevrons on, one on each shoulder like the U.S. has been traditionally. Their supplies were so limited that they ended up issuing one set of two per soldier, or NCO rather, that, you know, would have been wearing these chevrons. And one was for your service coat, which is this, and then one was for your overcoat, which you obviously know what they look like. So that's why they were only issued one. And that's why you see in World War One, they're not going to have any insignia on their right, on their left arm, or a unit patch, which I'll get into in a bit. But the ranks are going to be on the right shoulder if they had them. They got issued, during their combat, they got issued new uniforms as much as possible. They're old and tattered or dirty, or they had even an inkling that there was gas exposure, they would issue the person a new uniform. So these would be easy to take off and then put on your new uniform, but the rank patches, sewing your rank patch on every couple weeks pretty much, is pretty impractical. So a lot of the NCOs you'll see actually in the field don't wear insignia, but everybody knew who each other was, so that's why they don't do that. As far as the hat, the infamous, 1911 campaign hat, the Montana Peak, these were used for the guys that were just getting over there, because this is what we had as our pretty much hat. So nowadays we have the patrol cap. This is the equivalent of the patrol cap back then. It was really big, impractical, and they were starting to get issued helmets and other stuff. So a lot of the guys you'll see in France that are wearing these were A, not in the trenches. Yes, there are pictures, but it's few and far between. And B, they only had them for a few weeks, and then they either put them in storage or got rid of them because they're too big to carry on anything, because this pack doesn't allow you to carry anything more than the absolute basic equipment, because the Army always makes sense when they design stuff. So that's why I got the campaign hat on, and they would have worn these, and this is kind of what the geared-up doughboy would have been like right when they got to France. Obviously, they need a few more pieces of equipment, as per the other militaries that have been fighting there since 1914, so this next little segment, I'm going to put on what an NCO in my unit would have carried in the Second Battle of the Aisne in the forests, in the Argonne. Just, you'll see a lot more gear, a lot more changes. This is going to be gone, and we're going to get to that right now. I'm still going to have the same rifle because most of the videos and pictures that I've seen of our unit, the guys that went over there initially carried these as much as they could, unless they lost it, of course, but I'll show you what the other rifle looks like, but this is what I carry for the impression throughout the end of the war. So we'll get to that right now. So for part two of this video, you kind of notice already I've got a ton of more stuff on than in the first video. A lot of different things. Got the gas mask, which is the small box respirator, which was, of course, the most iconic thing. And they wore it with the snaps facing in because when you undo this and you're going to put the mask on, you don't want the flap getting in the way of the mask being on. You need to remove the face part, which looks like this. You got this little snorkel thing to bite down on, and then your nose gets pinched shut. This is a British one. They use a lot of British gear. I'll get to that in a second. They use a lot of foreign gear because we were so ill prepared for the war. It wasn't even funny. So this is what the small box respirator mask looks like. It's got a little can in it. This didn't come out, so it's kind of jammed in there. This would have had like a charcoal impregnated like cotton, really heavy cotton or wool filter in it. Some of them had asbestos in them, which we all know is really healthy to breathe in. These things did not seal around the face, which is why a lot of the people that were exposed to, say, chlorine and the infamous mustard gas, which really wasn't used that much, but it still was, got their faces burned because it didn't seal. Their lungs were okay, but their faces were affected. So that's the SBR. They also carry the French M2 on the side at the beginning, and then some people, like medics, carried them to put on their patients if they had them, like they're on a stretcher. But we didn't primarily use that one. We used the British and the American SBR, which look almost the same. I've got a wristwatch. It's actually kind of a neat little detail. It's a big deal because before World War I, wristwatches really weren't prevalent, if at all even existing. So what they did is they took their pocket watches and got bands made. This watch is a little bit big for the band, but whatever. And they put them on their wrists so they didn't have to sit there and dig through their pockets every time they were looking, you know, looking for the time. We'll start at the boots and kind of work our way up from there with all these little pieces. The boots are actually British boots. They're called ammo boots. The Americans wore American boots, which were really crappily made and just really cheap and chintzy, and they'd fall apart. The British and the French boots, which I don't have, were built a lot better, and they obviously had more of them because they were more prepared because they'd been fighting for 3 years. So the Americans used a lot of different footwear in World War I. The 1917 trench boot was prevalent, as well as the British and the French boots. So it's really a crapshoot when you're talking about that. The leg wraps, I forgot to mention in the first video, we went over there with a mix of the 1910 leggings, which are the canvas ones that you're pretty familiar with. And then some people stateside got issued the leg wraps. And then when they were over there, they got issued leg wraps too. Some units actually had leggings over there, which is kind of weird if you see pictures. Like the 30th Infantry Division had leggings and they used British weapons. The leg wraps were just better because they didn't rot off and they protected your legs a lot more. You'll notice in the first video I kind of had them wrapped, you know, pretty fast, and they didn't look the best because Americans weren't really familiar with them. So if you look at a lot of the early pictures, their leg wraps are kind of nasty looking, and it took them a lot of practice to get it down. These are wrapped like the French style. These bumps under here are just the trousers kind of bunching up and the whatever. They're supposed to be smooth, but for the sake of time and whatever, we'll just go with this. You see how they got the crisscross pattern right here? The French and the Indians and everybody else use those because it stays on a lot better when you've got the pattern crisscross like that for whatever reason. So Americans started doing that to make the leg wraps stay on more. There's just wool. They varied so much in size, length, shape, material. They had a lot of knit wool leg wraps. These are just regular wool. So again, the options are pretty much endless. Got the 1917 breeches or semi-breeches on again. That really didn't change. You can see 1912, 1917s being worn in theater. So yeah, those kind of just went on like pants, worn higher, of course. And then the 1917 tunic. On the tunic itself, still got the one rank chevron, the collar discs. A lot of the later collar discs would have been generic, you know, US and then cross rifles or whatever your branch was, instead of the specialized ones, but they still survived, so that's why I keep it on. Graffiti on gas mask bags. I did this when I first got the kit. Really wasn't totally accurate because this was an expendable item. Every time it got used or, you know, needed to be replaced, they'd chuck the whole thing and get a new one. So you probably wouldn't have had time to write on there like that. So call it Farby. It is what it is. I'll probably get a new one eventually, but this is a post-war thing a lot of times, post-armistice rather. For the belt, notice in the other video I had the 10 pocket 1910 belt. Now I've got a cavalry belt, a mounted cav belt that was used extensively by the infantry if they wanted to carry sidearms, which in 1918, General Pershing and others said, yeah, let's arm the Americans with whatever they can. Privates were carrying sidearms. And for the sidearm, I've got the 1917 Colt revolver in the 1909 holster. This is a 45 ACP, uses the 3-round moon clips, put two in the cylinder to load it. 6 shots, extremely accurate, reliable. Most people were familiar with revolvers back then. There's more of these used for sidearms than there were 1911s because they were cheaper to make, they were more familiar, and they just could stamp out more of them because they were already being manufactured. So while the 1911 was used, this was the more prevalent sidearm of the American Expeditionary Force. The 1909 holster, this is an original I'm going to have copied. I don't really want to mess with this one too much because it's pretty soft and old, or hard and old rather. But I'm going to get these reproduced and then be able to have a reproduction holster with the 1917. They were only made in left-handed for cavalry. So a lot of these guys, you see them wear them everywhere. I kind of got it back here for a secondary purpose. Some guys, like I'm going to do with the reproduction, I'm going to put a 1910 wire hook hanger on here and put it over on my right side. So it'll still be cross-draw, but I can get it, or I'll stick it right here, whichever. Got a bandolier, the 1903 bandolier. This is a cheap repro. They would have cardboard inserts in here. These guys strapped as many of these as they could on for ammo and stuff when they're going up to the front. The revolver, the cartridge, or the half moon clip pouch holds a 2.46 in here and takes the place of one pocket. So this is actually a 9-pocket belt instead of a 10. Move over here, we've got the M1917 trench knife, which I think I made a video on before. I tried to put it through a helmet, didn't work, probably because it's not original. But it's got the triangular blade on it, which is pretty cool. It's made to go through thick clothing and stuff. These were really prevalently used. The 1918 knuckle duster is what they call them or whatever. Or no, this is the knuckle duster. The one with the brass knuckles of the 1918 that the French were using. Really didn't come into play until late 1918 for the Americans. And this was more widely used. The trench knives were issued at a rate of approximately 40 per infantry company. And they were mainly issued to squad leaders if they were going up to the front, or if they were going to be doing like a trench raid or something. The raiding party would be issued these trench knives along with whatever else, pistols, clubs, you name it. The Americans were really heavily armed. I was talking to a friend of mine whose great-grandfather was in the First World War, fought just about everybody, and I asked him what his grandfather or great-grandfather said about the Americans, and he said that every time they sent Germans over there to, you know, probes, trench raids, they just get shot to shit. You could hear rifles and pistols going off, and they just wouldn't come back. So it was kind of a change-up from the standard European armies, where they had the rifles and the officers and NCOs primarily had handguns. So the Americans were just extremely well-armed, knives, guns, everything, which is really interesting, because it's kind of cool to know that nothing's really changed. Still got the 1903 rifle. I told you about that in the other video, or the other part of the video, and we've got also, this is what would have been issued to about 75% of the American Expeditionary Force. All replacements starting in 1918 would have been carrying the M1917 rifle. It's not an Eddystone, the 1917 Eddystone. It's actually called the U.S. model of 1917. Eddystone was one of the manufacturers, yes, but that's like calling an M1 Garand a Springfield. It just isn't correct. But this is a December of 1917 dated Winchester. Winchester, Remington, and Eddystone made these, because they're already making the Pattern 14 rifle, which is just this rifle chambered in 303 British. So this is what about 75% of the American Expeditionary Force would have had versus the 1903. It all depended on what unit you were in and if you were a replacement when you got in. So just a little note about that. Got a French canteen on here, the 1887 model or something, the 2-liter. Missing a little cork or the wood stopper. I don't know where the hell that went. I'll find it though. This was because, like I mentioned in the earlier part of the video, this 1-quart canteen isn't going to get you very far in a combat situation. You need to drink a lot of water, especially when you're wearing all this gear. Wool is not that bad, despite what people think. It breathes, and once you start sweating, you actually stay pretty cool. But you still need to drink a shitload of water. So this actually adds another 2 liters of water. The French put wine in here a lot, but the Americans mainly used it for water. And they use British canteens, whatever they could get their hands on. I have yet to see a picture of somebody carrying 2 American canteens, so I kind of don't really want to be that guy and do that, even though I would love to, because I need a ton of water at events, because I'm a camel. Anyways, so you got the French canteen. Now the pack itself got some little goodies attached to it that would have been attached if somebody was marching up to the front line, because they were rotated in and out of the trenches in 3 to 7 day rotations. They weren't sitting up there for months on end. So these guys would be back in their rest area, you know, maintaining their equipment, marching around, doing their stuff, kind of chilling out. And then when they go up to the front, this would be their heavy marching armor. Got an extra pair of boots on there, the U.S. trench boots, a trench periscope, which is on this side, which is a very simple device that can actually save a lot of lives just by looking over the top instead of sticking your head up. Bayonet's still on there. They would have probably put it on their belt if they needed it. And then I've got a souvenir German ammo pouch that actually serves a functional purpose, you know, carrying extra equipment and stuff, because this pack, you cannot carry anything more than what they issue you. And even that's kind of a stretch. So a lot of the Americans were really avid souvenir hunters, which also hasn't changed. And they picked up anything they could, you know, bring home or even use. A lot of guys would be using that stuff. That's a German flashlight. Actually, this one's a Swedish one, but it's pretty identical to the World War I German flashlights. So I have that too, because Americans, if they did issue flashlights, they weren't really built well and they weren't really common. So figured American soldier would have wanted one of those for functional purposes and because it's a cool souvenir. And then that brings us up to the helmet, which was issued. We used the British design. Most Americans actually use the British Brodie helmet, like the 1917 pattern, before we even got the American one. And the difference between the American and the British one is that the rivets on the chin strap bales on the British ones would have been like a split pin coming out. The American ones were actually just a rivet like that, a single rivet. So this is a reproduction of an American one, probably the best repro you can buy for your money, Prairie Flower Leather Company. Just fantastic repro, handmade liners, stamped on an original press, just good stuff. But so this is exactly what they would have looked like. They had like an oil cloth, you know, tarry canvas, and then the wool pad, the leather chin strap, and the adjustment net. Pretty basic liner, but still effective. So you see the difference in the amount of gear alone carried by the American Doughboy in World War I, just from a few months worth of, you know, getting gear, getting foreign gear. A lot of us carried foreign gear. So it's just kind of cool to see pictures of Americans in combat. Most of the time, actually, I'll show you, they didn't carry their packs into combat a lot of times. Maybe a couple guys would have carried essential stuff up. But for the most part, this is what you're going to see in a wartime American, is just this, without the pack. They did have the pack on. Most of the time, they didn't have the tail on. It all depended on your unit's SOP and all that stuff. So this is just basic light stuff, so you can move. You don't have that big pack on. You've got all your ammo, your gas mask, which is the most important for their psychological fear, even though gas accounted for less than 1% of all the casualties in World War I. It's still the psychological fear, so this is always here. Rear of lines that would have been worn at the low position down here, the strap would have been let out and you would have worn it around like a sling. But yeah, so this is what the wartime American Doughboy would have looked like. Obviously there's so many variations. I'm just showing you my impression. I've got a lot of original pictures as references. Another thing that's kind of added is the trench whistle. This is a British bobby style whistle, again foreign. They had the US style with the ball in there, the Acme Thunder or whatever. I just chose to carry this one. So NCOs would have carried these. It does work. That's about half the amount that you're supposed to blow to make it loud. It's really loud. So you can hear it very well. So NCOs would have carried that, or the American one, or whatever whistle they could have had. But it's still very basic stuff. There's not a lot to it. So by November 1918, this is what they had, and they would have had more bandoliers and all that stuff, and you name it. I mean, there's so many original pictures of just this mod podge of gear. Americans not wearing their uniform, you know, properly and, you know, all pretty like the Europeans, but they got shit done. So, no, I'm not saying they won World War I. So before you jump on me for that, I'm not saying. I'm saying they threw a bunch more fresh guys on one side, and that's how the war came to a halt, is that we didn't win it single-handedly. The British, the French, the Canadians, everybody else did their part. We just kind of were there for the final days and decided to take credit for it, which is kind of dumb. But I digress. So now I'm going to show you the basic, after the armistice was signed, when my unit marched into Germany for a long ways, ended up being on occupation duty until March of 1919, which wasn't that long, but they had been fighting since the beginning of our involvement in combat, so I think they deserve that break. So anyway, I'm going to get into that stuff, and I'm going to kind of show you the difference. So you've got, so far we've got the just getting there in France impression with just the American basic gear that's not really designed for trench warfare and European warfare. I've got this, where you've got a bunch of foreign gear, in your combat stuff, get your helmet, you get your mask, the watches and everything. And I'm just going to show you the basic uniform of the post-armistice. Shouldn't take that long, but I'll debunk a couple little myths, and we'll go from there. So now, after the armistice was signed and combat action had ceased, the Americans were, along with the French, British, or the Commonwealth, rather, and all the other allies, on occupation duty in Germany, making sure everything was okay, demilitarizing the country, getting just stupid occupation stuff. They did the same in the Second World War, but it was a little bit more thorough. So basically, the Americans started sewing on their unit patches at this point. And again, there's a million variations, but and then they started putting patches on their uniforms because obviously they were issued the same uniform. So for this one, I've got the 32nd Infantry's or 32nd Division's patch on. Most of them were hand cut from felt, hand sewn, just really non-uniform, but generally the same. So you could tell a lot of other units did this too. That's why you see a lot of patches on tunics or service coats rather. Down here you've got the service stripes, the overseas service stripes. A lot of these were handmade or made in little shops in France and Germany post-armistice. So our unit would have had two of these. Actually, they would have had a silver one and two gold ones or brown ones. They vary so much. There's some that are gold. They're all made out of different material. So I just chose to do that. On the ISARM on the bottom, they have a chevron on there. That's a wound chevron. They didn't have the Purple Heart at that point. So if you were exposed to gas or wounded and required medical treatment, you were authorized to wear a wound stripe. My corporal chevrons are also handmade because a lot of them, the supply was so backed up by the time they were at the end that they didn't have a lot. So if somebody really wanted to show that they were an NCO, they would have made their own patch. I've seen a couple originals, actually quite a few originals that are handmade stuff. The tunic, again, is just a 1917 tunic. The trousers or breeches are 1917. They're still wearing the leg wraps most of the time. Some of them wore the leggings with their boots that would have been shined and not dirty like this. So that's kind of inaccurate, but I don't have time to shine those, and I don't really want to right now because it's for a field impression. NCOs would have still probably had a whistle because there was a lot of like policing to do and stuff like that, and traffic control, you name it, and it's also a decoration. They would have worn their badges and some ribbons that they would have had before. It all depended on the individual and what they had available to them. Some guys kept this stuff, and it traveled with them throughout the entire conflict. Some guys didn't have any of this, so they would have just worn whatever. Collar discs are the same as the other one, so people would have a lot of pride, and you'd have probably seen a lot more of the unit specific collar discs at the end. But nevertheless, again, there's a million variations. They wore the what we call the overseas cap now, and they call it then. It's actually just kind of the idea of the French bonnet de police that they started wearing. The British started wearing because the service cap was too big and all that stuff. The Americans replaced the campaign hat with this. So when they were off the lines, they would have been wearing a variation, which there's like another 15 variations of the overseas cap. This is one of the British style hats. They had the French style, the American style, which is kind of the rounded one that you see now. The Glengarry, which has got the two buttons, this style, and then the first pattern, which is just kind of a weird looking hat. So I mean, there's just a million possibilities, but just doing this for representation. They would have been wearing these, or some actually had their campaign hats saved, like they would have had this stuff saved. So they could have worn their campaign hats, unit patches, shooting badges, ribbons, stuff like that. But still, this is pretty basic compared to nowadays. You've got all this bling on your uniform. So they would have been doing simple tasks, just wearing this. Some would have had a pistol belt with a sidearm, if need be. Sentries would have had rifles. But it was down back to the basic sort of stateside, yet combination of stateside and overseas gear and equipment and uniforms. So that's just a really neat time period. And our unit left in March of 1919 and came back, and they were wearing all this stuff. And that's why you can find original tunics with, or I keep calling them tunics, they're actually called service coats, with the unit patches. And, the red stripe you see right here is actually not a rank. It's actually a honorable discharge chevron, the red stripe. Overseas service stripes were weird, or service stripes rather. Overseas ones were gold. Some guys just made them brown. I've got a couple that are black almost, original ones, but I mean gold. Stateside service would have been a silver chevron for every 6 months. And they also had one for guys that were there for less than 6 months, but nevertheless still in France, and those would have been blue, like a infantry blue chevron. So the service stripes are, that's how you can kind of tell. It's hard to tell in black and white, but on originals that you can find and buy, that's what those mean. Yeah, so this is pretty much it. A lot of 1918 Pershing service coats would have been used in the Army of Occupation too. It's just like this without the outside pockets. Still got the flaps. It's just a little bit different. 1912 uniforms. So it's just there's no right answer. There's no wrong answer. As long as your stuff's historically accurate and it would have been used, you can get away with a lot of stuff doing American Expeditionary Force in World War One, which is the cool part about it. Again, like you can notice my breeches and my tunic don't match. Service coat don't match. Everybody says, "Oh, your uniform needs to match." Well, that's actually a fallacy. Because back in the day, every country, no matter what they were, France, Germany, no matter how nice their uniforms were, their dye lots were still mixed by hand. And the Americans specifically said in 1917 when they got involved, okay, you need to crank out as many of these uniforms as possible because we're going from 200,000 to 400 or 4 million men. So we need just, if it falls within this color range, just do it. As long as the uniform's made. So you're going to see a lot of the pockets are not evenly cut. They're not the same size. They just look like crap. And you're going to see a million shades and styles of wool. Some are nice, some are not so nice. There's, again, no right or wrong answer. Well, the right answer is you probably won't match because there's a million different makers, manufacturers. Even nowadays, Army uniforms don't match when you get them issued. If you look closely, they're different shades, and that's all computerized, so it's supposed to be the same. So imagine you're mixing dye by hand. I mean, American uniforms range from brown to, like, almost all of drab to, like, khaki, and then the grain of wool. Some of it's really nice. Some of it's just shit. A lot of people did private purchase stuff post-armistice and even pre-armistice, so you can tell by the quality of wool. This is supposed to be, like, issued stuff because the issued service coats I have are just garbage as far as the wool. And they're brown. This is actually the same color as one of my originals. So, yeah, I hope this video was kind of informative. I'm not an expert on this by any means, so don't start pissing and moaning thinking that I know everything, because I don't. I know what I've researched, and I've kind of been able to discern the bullshit from the real reality of it from other sources that have been doing it a hell of a lot longer. So I'm just kind of conveying what I've seen, what I've come to know is right and correct. I debunk a couple myths, like the unit patches. Sorry you didn't wear unit patches. Like maybe one or two units did in late October of 1918, but it's a post-armistice thing. Same with the painting on the helmets, writing on the gas mask bag, so they didn't do it in the field most of the time. Yeah, so if you got any questions, I'll try to answer them. I'm fairly knowledgeable on this subject. I'm not an expert by any means, but it's what I've been doing for the past 3 years is just nonstop researching what they carried, you know, this, that, the other thing. So if you got any questions, I'll try to answer. And if I don't know, I'll point you to somebody who will know. So I appreciate you watching. Like and subscribe. Obviously, the Great War stuff's coming up. Battlefield 1's coming out. So hopefully that'll generate some interest in the reenacted community. And it won't die out after 1918 because World War One was a pretty big deal. And eventually I'm going to get other impressions together. I just started with American because it's actually really easy for us to get the stuff and the equipment's here. And it's a lot more research is available as far as American soldiers and original pictures. But I'll be doing other impressions too, make videos on those. Yeah, hopefully you guys get into the hobby. I know where to get all the uniforms. I have them made as accurately and inconsistently as possible as far as color and material. So if you're interested in a uniform, let me know. I'll get you hooked up. Yeah, that wraps up the video. Like and subscribe. Appreciate you watching. Thanks.